there's someone there. It's so bleeding awful. I'm really, really scared when I'm watching spooky movies. Watching spooky movies on the Late Late Show. Rummaging the cupboard with the possum pants. I had no bleeding sleep. There's noises on the stairs. I smell an awful odour. Is there someone there? I hold my girl real close. I know she's really scared when we're watching spooky movies. Watching spooky movies.
Let's see. I have my my popcorn, and the movie is all set up and ready to go. And I don't have a beverage. Hello, creepies. Dr. Sigmund Zoid here, and you have logged on just in time. It's Alternative Realities TV, and it's the New Year's Eve edition. We are getting ready to change from the year 2012, I guess that's your year, and over to the year 2013, and so it's going to be happening in just a little bit, but in the meantime, I'm here in the castle all by myself. The slug is gone. She's gone off to New York, to Times Square, to do some kind of, I don't know, she said something about a live show, I don't know. Anyway, I don't have the slug here to mess things up, you know what I'm saying? You know, she can't create any chaos, none of her hijinks tonight. I can watch a movie that I want to see. So tonight I have a very special film in mind, and I've got my popcorn here, and by the way, this is Jay Higgs kettle corn, and it is amazing. You simply have to try some. Anyway, tonight I'm going to show a film that I want to see myself. The slug thinks I've got her fooled. She thinks that I'm in the laboratory working on an experiment. I told her I would be, you know, productive while she was away. But little does she know that I'm actually just going to kick back here in my underoos and watch a movie. It's going to be great. So, at any rate, before we start tonight's film, you still have time to go pop yourself some popcorn, and then we are going to get right into the feature film of the evening. Tonight's alternative reality takes us on a journey from the holiday season almost 100 years into the future. It is a story of the fall of humankind and the resurrection of the human spirit. Tonight, I am bringing you a trip into a post-apocalyptic future known as Things to Come. We'll get started, and I'll be back with you in just a little bit. Enjoy!
Thank you. Hello, young Harding. You're early.
Yes, I'd finished up. It was too late starting fresh. What's all this fuss about in the papers tonight, Mr. Cavell?
Wars and rumors of wars.
Crying wolf?
Someday a wolf will come. These fools are capable of anything.
In that case, what happens to medical research?
It has to stop.
That'll mess me up.
Mess you up. Mess everything up. My God, if war gets loose again.
Happy Christmas, everyone. While shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground.
What's the matter with you fellas? All that. This little upset across the water doesn't mean anything. Threatened men live long and threatened wars never occur.
Another speech by him.
But I tell you, there's nothing in it. It's just to buck people up about the air estimates. Now, why meet wars halfway? Why not look on the bright side of things? You're all right. Your business is going up. You've got a jolly wife, a pretty home.
All's right with the world, eh? Mm. All's right with the world.
Certainly.
Passworthy, you should have been called Pippa Passworthy.
Oh, and Cabal, you've been smoking too much. You're not eupeptic. Oh, come on, it's Christmas.
Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel.
Nice toys they have nowadays. Nice toys. The toys we had were simpler, ever so much simpler. Noah's Arks and wooden soldiers. Nothing complex like these. You know, I wonder sometimes if perhaps all these new toys aren't a bit too much for them.
It teaches them to use their hands.
And I suppose their grandchildren will see even more wonderful things. Progress, progress. I'd like to see the wonders they'll see.
Don't be too sure of progress.
Oh, listen to the incurable pessimist.
What's to stop progress nowadays? War.
Firstly, there isn't going to be a war. And secondly, war doesn't stop progress. It stimulates progress.
Yes, war can be a highly stimulating thing. But you can overdo a stimulant.
Oh, well, after all, I'll be exaggerating the horrors of war. Don't we rather overdo that song? After all, you know, the last war wasn't as bad as some people make out. We didn't worry. Something great seemed to have got hold of us.
Something greater still may get hold of us next time. If we don't end war, war will end us.
Well, what can you do?
Yeah. What can we do?
Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. Real old-fashioned Christmas this year. Fresh little snow with a nip in the air, eh?
What was that? Sounded like a gun.
Oh, guns here. Mr. Cabell, here's to another good year for all of us. Another year of recovery, eh?
What are the searchlights doing now?
Yes. Well, it must be anti-aircraft maneuvers.
Maneuvers at Christmas? No.
Listen, guns again.
Yeah? Cabell speaking. The hills are out from the street.
Mobilization.
Oh, God.
Perhaps it's only precautionary mobilization.
The unknown aircraft passed over Sea Beach and dropped bombs within a few hundred yards of the waterworks. They then turned seaward again. By this time, they'd been picked up with the searchlights of the battleship Dinosaur. Before they could mount out of range, she had opened upon them with her anti-aircraft gun. Unfortunately, without result.
Of course, everyone has said this time they'll start without any declaration of war.
Oh, listen.
We do not yet know the nationality of these aircraft, though, of course, there can be little doubt of their place of origin. But before all things, it is necessary for the country to keep calm. No doubt the losses suffered by the fleet are serious.
That losses of the fleet?
Listen.
And it is imperative that the whole nation should at once stand to arms. Orders for a general mobilization have been issued, and the precautionary civilian organization against gas will at once be put into operation. Our instructions have just come to hand. We shall cut off for 5 minutes, and then read you the general instructions. Please call in all your friends. Call in everyone you can.
You've got your stimulant, Passworthy. Something great has got you. War has come.
There may be an air raid, but it is not likely to be a very serious one. You must be prepared for it. The danger will not be great. As soon as the danger is over, bugles will sound all clear. The streets will be dangerous. Do not assemble in crowds. Keep indoors. Go home. Those who are far from home can take refuge in the underground railways. Go home. Go home. Go home. Get out of the square. Get out of the streets. Go home and keep home. Put out your lights. Go to the window. With a wet sheet or a wet blanket over the door of the window.
Sorry we had these children.
No. Life must carry on. Why should we surrender life to the brutes and fools?
I loved you. I wanted to serve you and make life happy for you. But think of the things that may happen to them. Were we selfish?
You weren't afraid to bear them. We were children yesterday. We're anxious. But we're not afraid. Rip. Courage, my dear. And may that little heart have courage.
Well, you've got to do your bit, you know, Sonny. Got to do your bit.
I'm an officer too, Daddy.
That's the spirit. Carry on, sir. Carry on. Goodbye, son. There. Quick, boss.
An air raid is approaching every town. Gas masks are being distributed. See that they're fit tightly behind the ears. Get to cover. Get under cover at once. The enemy are not in any great force, and our anti-aircraft gunners will speedily destroy them.
bad shape, eh? Why does it come to this?
God, why do we have to murder each other?
Go, my friend. That is my guess. It's a bad guess. Funny if I'm killed by my own poison.
Quick, get this. Get this on quickly.
Give it to her. I've given plenty to others. Why should I not have some myself? Give it to her. I'm done.
Breathe through your mouth.
I dropped the gas on her. Maybe I've killed her father and mother. Maybe I've killed her whole family. And then I go and give up my mask to save her. That's funny. That's a joke.
Last drop.
God,
What is the use of trying to save this mad world from this punishment?
Oh, Father, if only you could get some sleep.
How can I sleep? See how they wander out to die.
Just shoot them. It's their lives or ours. Make a court.
That's how they dealt with the pestilence in the dark ages.
Richard.
My sister. Gordon! How do you know? Her heart beats faster. She feels faint and she won't answer. What can I do for her? I thought something might be known.
Oh, Janet. And you poor dear. Richard.
I might be infected.
Is there nothing to make her comfortable?
Nothing will make anyone comfortable anymore.
Just tuning in, I am Dr. Sigmund Zoid, and you are watching Alternative Realities TV. It's New Year's Eve 2012. In just a little while, it's going to be the year 2013, and we'll all be moving on conveyor belts and have flying cars and all kinds of things. Trust me, it's true. Anyway, tonight, we are watching the great film, Things to Come, and without any interruptions from Sluggo. Yeah, she's away at Times Square, ringing in the new year with Dick Clark. Is he even alive? Oh, that's right. She said the ghost of Dick Clark. So I guess he's passed on. At any rate, so I get to show a film that I want to see. And I don't have to put up with any of her nonsense. Anyway, I'm about to go get me something, another little snack. The popcorn is about empty. So I'm thinking maybe, what would be good? Oh, I know, pizza rolls. I'm going to go fix some pizza rolls, and we're going to watch some trailers for some other futuristic films while I do that, and then we'll get right back into Things to Come right here on Alternative Realities. See you in a little bit.
As we all know, the biological and social stimulation of the family leads to private reflection outside party needs.
Mm-hmm.
You're thoughtful.
Unorthodox loyalties which can only lead to thought crime. It's true.
Strength and youth are sacrificed. Who are they?
There are thought criminals who maintain resistance is not real. Believe me, Winston. It's very real. A brother from the age of the Thought Police.
30 to 40 group, take your places, please.
Double plus goodness. Junior. I didn't think there was a single piece of meat in this steer.
You knew this would happen, sir.
The individual is only a cell.
Council, in its infinite wisdom, has decided these two numbers are to be disposed of. The Biochemical Forum has demands to make on their parts, however, before they are eliminated. That's the kind of efficiency that makes you proud to live in this era. Are we happy and effective? Consultation with leading experts in the field makes it perfectly clear, that we are all now programmed for perfect happiness, perfect happiness.
Level 38, we're trapped.
All right. What did they do to you?
There are, of course, occasional technical or electronic errors in programming and or surveillance which produce perverse exceptions.
I'm going to have a child.
First they start skipping prescribed drug dosages, then they begin touching, then indulging in various sexual acts, and the ultimate perversion, love. For such extreme psychobiological misfunction, only isolation will do. Despite rumors to the contrary, it should be made perfectly clear, there have been no, repeat, no unprogrammed departures, no pursuits. People will attack any persons venturing beyond prescribed areas.
1970. The pestilence has ceased. Thanks to the determined action of our chief in shooting all wanderers, there have been no cases for 2 months. The pestilence has been conquered. The chief is preparing to resume hostilities against the hill people with the utmost vigor. Soon we shall have victory and peace. All is well. God save the chief. God save our land.
Have any more insulated wire?
But no rubber wire at all, sir.
Any rubber tape?
There's not a scrap left in the place. We used the last on the other motor.
Oh, what's the use? There's no petrol anyway. I don't believe there's 3 gallons of petrol left in this accursed ruin of a town. What's the good of sitting here at a job like this? Nothing will ever fly again. Flying's over. Everything's over. Civilization's dead.
The rooms, isn't it?
Yes. It's a good pre-pestilence machine. I oil it and turn it over at times.
You think it'll go fast someday still?
Oh, I'm not one of your petrol hoarders. But all the same, that engine turns over still. Why, I remember when I was a lad, when it was new, we thought nothing of going 100 miles in it. A whole 100 miles. Less than 3 hours I've done it in. Oh, that sort of thing's all gone now. Gone forever, eh? Huh?
Great, sir.
Yep, yep.
Richard.
What is it?
You won't think me mad.
Why, darling?
I thought I heard an aeroplane this morning. At dawn. I thought it was a dream, but...
Nonsense. I tell you, flying's finished. We shall never get in the air again. Never.
I do what I can, but you can't fly without petrol.
I'll get petrol for you. Trust me, you look after the machines. I know you haven't got the stuff, but you can get round that. For example, transfer parts. Use bits of one to mend another. Be resourceful. Give me only 10 machines in working order. Give me only 5. I don't want them all. And we'll end this war of ours forever. I'll see you get your reward.
Is your wife, Gordon? You keep her well hidden. Salutation, lady. Use your influence with our master mechanic. The competent state wants his service.
I'm sure my husband does his best for you.
That's hardly enough, lady. The competent state demands miracles.
Not everyone could work miracles as you do, Chief.
Oh, I'm sure you could work miracles if you tried, lady.
Rudolph!
Lady, I showed it to you, but you said you didn't want it.
Wonski's been up to his tricks again, he'll have to answer for them.
But he's been keeping things back from me again.
Only Wonski keeps things back. What do you think of our master mechanic here, the one that may have those planes of mine to end this war of ours with the Hillman?
Well, can't you make him? I thought you could make everybody do everything.
Some things you can't do, madam. You can't fly without petrol. You can't mend machines without tools or material. You've gone back too far. Flying's become a lost skill in every town.
Are you really as stupid as that?
I'm as helpless as that.
And now, Chief, what are you going to do about it?
He's going to let me have those machines, and I'm going to let him have coal. Stuff to make oil.
It's a lost skill. It's a dream of the... There it is. You were right. A plane once more. Look, there he is.
Look.
He's shutting off. He's coming down.
What's the meaning of this?
Aeroplanes before us! And you told me we couldn't fly anymore. While we've been fumbling, they've been active. Here's some of you, you and you.
Find out who this is and what it means. There's only one man in it. Hold him.
Somewhere they can still make new machines. I didn't dream it was still possible.
Yes, but who is this man? How does he dare come here?
Pitch him to the town hall. Guard his machine and bring him to me there.
Come along, Mary. I must see that machine.
Who's in control of this part of the country?
The chief. What we call the boss.
Good. I want to see him.
He sent me to arrest you.
You can't do that. But I'll come and see him.
Well, you're under arrest whether you'll admit it or not. The country's in a state of war.
Well, come along. I know the way.
I remember this place well. I used to live over there for years. Ever heard of a man named Partsworthy? Harding?
Look, here he comes now. Yes, thank
you. So you're Harding.
I seem to remember something about you.
You were a young man.
You're John Cabell. I remember you. I used to visit your house here, endless years ago before the wars. You're still flying. Your hair is gray, but you look young enough.
How are things here? Who's in control in this place?
Well, we have a chief, a warlord.
The usual thing. I want to look up your warlord. Where can we go and talk?
In my laboratory is the best thing. It's just over here.
Right. Oh, come on. Come on.
You can't go in there. You're under arrest. You've got to go with me to the chief.
All in good time. I must see this gentleman first.
Well, you've got to go with me. Orders are orders. The boss first. Where is this man? Why isn't he brought here?
Well, he's got up with Dr. Hardy.
He has to be brought here. I must deal with him.
Yeah, you can't go to him. That's impossible. He must come to you.
Now, send another man for him. Send three men. He's got to be brought here.
So that's the sort of man your boss is. Not an unusual type. Everywhere we find these little semi-military upstarts robbing and fighting. That's what endless warfare's led to. Brigandage. What else could happen? But we, who are all that are left of the old engineers and mechanics, have pledged ourselves to salvage the world. We have the airways, all that's left of them. We have the seas. And we have ideas in common. The brotherhood of efficiency. The Freemasonry of science. We're the last trustees of civilization when everything else has failed.
I've been waiting for this. I'm yours to command.
Not mine. Not mine. No more bosses. Civilization's to command.
Tell him he'll have to come. He won't come on foot.
Well, we'll have to carry him.
I don't know what'll happen to me, sir, if you don't come.
Well, what do you want to see me about?
Who are you? Do you know this country's at war?
At war? Still at it, eh? We must clean that up.
What do you mean, we must clean it up? All war. Who are you, I say?
The law. Law and sanity.
I am the law here.
I said law and sanity.
Where do you come from? Who are you?
Wings over the world.
Well, you know you can't come into a country like this in this fashion.
I'm here. Do you mind if I sit down?
And now, for the fourth time, who are you?
I tell you, wings over the world.
That's nothing. What government do you under?
Common sense. I belong to World Communications. We just run ourselves.
And? You'll run into trouble if you try and land here in wartime. What's the game?
Order and trade.
Trade, eh?
Can you do anything in munitions?
Not our line of business.
Fuel, spare parts. We've got planes. I've got boys that have trained a bit on the ground. We've no fuel. It hampers us. We might do a deal.
We might.
I know where I can get some fuel. I've got my plans later, but if you can manage a temporary accommodation, we'd do business.
World communications helps no one to make war.
End war. I want to make victorious peace.
I seem to have heard that phrase before, when I was a young man. But it made no end of war.
Now look here, Mr. Aviator, let's see how we stand. Come down to actuality. The way you swagger, you don't seem to realize you're under arrest. You and your machine.
You'll find other planes looking for me if I happen to be delayed.
We'll deal with them later. Now you can start a trading agency here if you like. I've no objection. The first thing we shall want is to get our planes in the air again.
Quite a laudable ambition. But our new order has an objection to private aeroplanes.
The impudence.
I'm not talking about private aeroplanes. Our aeroplanes are public aeroplanes. This is an independent sovereign state at war. I know nothing about any old order. I'm the chief here, and I'm not taking any orders, old or new, from you.
I suppose I've walked into trouble.
Yeah, you can take that as right.
Where have you come from?
I flew from our headquarters at Basra this morning. We have some hundreds of new type planes, and we're building more, fast. The factories are working again. We're gradually restoring order and trade in the whole Mediterranean area. We're scouting this region now to see how things are.
You found out. This is an independent sovereign state.
Yes, we must talk about that.
We don't discuss it.
We don't approve of independent sovereign states.
You don't approve?
We mean to stop them.
That's war.
If you will.
All right, I think we know how we stand. Burton, take this man. If he gives you any trouble, club him. You hear that, Mr. Wings over your wits?
My friends know my whereabouts. If I don't come back, they'll send a force to find me.
Perhaps they won't find you.
They'll find you.
They'll find me ready. Take him to the detention room downstairs.
Now, was that wise?
Wise?
Yes, wise, to quarrel with him at once.
Quarrel with him? Confound him if again to quarrel with me. You must clean that up.
Clean that up?
My wall.
There's things behind him.
Things behind him? Some sort of aerial bus driver standing up to me. Like an equal.
So you lost your temper and you bullied him.
I don't bully. I just handle the man.
Sluggo, and I'm here to offer you my wisdom to help you with your troubled relationships and love lives. Do you have a problem you need advice for? Email me at sluggoslug@gmail.com. Maybe I'll put your letter on the air. Now, let's get to today's Sluglorn viewers.
Dear Sluggo, my boyfriend thinks I talk too much. Can you believe that? Like, just the other day, I was talking to him about our new marching band show, and he told me outright that he didn't care. I was so hurt. I feel like if he doesn't want to listen to me talk, then he shouldn't be with me. I'm right, right? I hope you understand what I'm saying, but in case you don't, here's an example. The other day, our marching band instructor gave us a new theme for our new show. Me and Livy were really excited. This year, we're going to do a show about dreams. And the cool thing is we all get to walk into the field with pillows and take a nap in the middle of the show. How cool is that? But he thought it was stupid. Well, anyway, then in the beginning of the show, there's like this lullaby thing, and it's like from Norway or Wales or somewhere. Is Wales even still a country? But you know the song if you heard it.
What was that? Honey, men have selective hearing. So unless what you are saying includes the words sports, food, huge, or yes, they ain't gonna hear ya. And it doesn't even matter as long as they pretend they are listening. because they're never going to have any good advice to offer anyway. If you want someone to listen to you, talk to one of your girlfriends or E.F. Hutton. Now, take a Xanax, dear, and write me again tomorrow. Next!
Dear Sluggo, I met this girl on the internet, and I really like her. I like her so much, I even got her name tattooed on my neck. We've been going out for a month, but she kept closing her curtains when I came around. I'm sure she really likes me, though, because she sent me a love letter and even had the sheriff deliver it. I made her a special place at my house with a lock of her hair, some things I got from her garbage, and a sock she left behind at the laundromat, which smells phenomenal, by the way. But Sluggo, the problem is that she won't ever come visit me here at my new place with the soft wallpaper. How do I get her attention? Signed, Captain Howdy.
Okay, Dear Captain Howdy, cue the music, Zoid. Artwork with macaronis, and don't worry about getting the shock therapy. I've heard the effects are short term. But maybe you should lay off listening to your police records. Oh, well, folks, that's all we have time for today. Let this be a lesson to my other viewers as I point out blind love is true. See ya! Remember, Sluggo loves you!
That means, my dear. You want aeroplanes, don't you? You want your aeroplanes put in order?
A really clever man could have had some of those machines up long ago.
I'm sure of it.
Along comes this stranger who's going to clean me up.
You expect me to hand my planes over to him, lock, stock, and barrel?
Why talk nonsense? You could have persuaded him under supervision.
Supervision? The sort of oafs are here to supervise him. He'd be too much for them.
Oh, well, of course, if he's going to be too much for you, why don't you hang him and hide his machine before the others are after you?
I don't agree with you. I don't agree with you. Now, this stranger hasn't taken me by surprise. I knew he was coming. Yes, I knew he was coming. I felt this conspiracy of air bus drivers brewing somewhere in the world. I felt they were getting ahead with their aeroplanes down there somewhere. Very well, now's our chance. We've got this fella bottled up. They won't even begin to miss him for days. I've got everything fixed now for an attack straight away on the Floss Valley to the old coal and shale pits where there's oil too. Then, up we buzz.
approaches. Your sacrifices have not been in vain. Our old struggle with the Hillman has come to its climax. Our new victory at the coal pits has brought a great supply of oil within our reach. Once more, we may hope to take the air. Look our invaders in the face. With 40 aeroplanes, larger force, I venture to say, as any in the world. This new oil can be adapted to our needs. That's quite a simple business. Nothing remains but the conclusive bombing of the hills. Then for a time, we can hope for a rich, rewarding peace. A peace of the strong man armed who keepeth his house. And now at this supreme crisis, you, Gordon, our master mechanic, refuse your help. Where are my planes?
The job's more difficult than you think. Half your machines are hopelessly old. You'll have 20 sound ones. To be exact, 19. We'll never get the others off the ground. The thing can't be done as you imagine it. I want assistance.
What assistance?
Your prisoner.
What, you want that chap in black that wings over the world? You want him released?
He knows his business. I don't. Enough. Make him my technical advisor.
I don't trust you technical chaps.
Then you won't get an aeroplane up.
I want those planes.
Well, if you get it. Then I want Dr. Harding out, too.
Well, the socialists.
I can't help that. If anybody in every town can adapt to that crude oil for our aeroplanes, it's Harding. If not, it can't be done.
Well, we had a bit of an argument with Harding.
He's the only man who can do this work for you.
Get him. Undo his hands. Well?
Well, what?
The salute.
Yeah, the salute.
Yeah. Oh, never mind the salute now. We'll talk about that later. Now, look here. Let's see how we stand. You, Gordon, are to undertake the reconstruction of our Air Force. The prisoner, Cabal, is to be placed at your disposal. Everywhere he goes, he's to be under guard and observation. No relaxing in that. Neither you nor he are to go within 100 yards of his airplane. Mind that. Now, you, Harding, are to assist Gordon with his cure problem. Place your knowledge of poison gas at our disposal.
I have nothing to do with poison gas.
You've got the knowledge of I have to wring it out of you. State your mother, your father, the totality of your interests. No discipline can be too severe for the man that denies that by word or deed.
Nonsense. We have a duty to civilization. You and your sort are driving us straight back to eternal barbarism.
But this is pure treason.
I protest against being dragged away from my work. Confound your silly war, your war material, and all the rest of it. All my life has been interrupted and wasted and spoiled by war. I am not standing any longer.
But this is treason, treason,
come. No, stop that.
We've need of your service.
Well, what do you want?
You're conscripted. You're under my orders now, and under no other orders in the world. I'm master here, I'm the state. I need fuel and gas.
Neither fuel nor gas.
You refuse?
Absolutely.
I don't want to be forced to extremities.
May I have a word? I understand you want all of those out-of-date clocks of yours, which you call your Air Force, to fly again and fly well.
They shall!
With the help of that man, Cabell, you have in the cells, Dr. Harding here, and we even have a dozen of your planes in the air again.
You! You're a traitor to civilization. I won't touch it!
If you will give me Cabell, and if you leave me free to talk with Harding, I promise you, you'll see your Air Force, a third of it at any rate, in the sky again.
You talk as if you're driving a bargain with me.
I'm sorry, Chief. It's not I who makes these conditions. This is the nature of things. You're going to have technical services. You're going to have scientific help without treating the men who give it to you properly.
That's what I said all along. You're bullying too hard, my dear, and there's a limit to bullying. Why? You can't make a dog hunt by beating it?
I want those planes!
I wanted to look at you.
I am at your service, madam.
You're the most interesting thing that has happened in every town for years.
You honor me.
You come from outside. I began to forget there was anything outside. I want to hear about it.
May I offer you my only chair?
You know, I'm not a stupid woman.
I'm sure.
This life here is limited. War always going on and never ending. Flags marching. Oh, I adore the chief. I've always adored him since he took control in the pestilence days when everyone else lost heart. He rules. He's firm. Everyone, every woman finds him strong and attractive. I can't complain. I have everything that is to be had here, and yet, this is a small, limited world we live in. You bring in the breath of something greater. When I saw you swooping down out of the air, when I saw you marching into the town hall, I felt this man lives in a greater world. And you spoke of the Mediterranean and the East, of your camps and factories. I read about the Mediterranean and Egypt and Greece and India. Oh, I can read a lot of those old books. I'm not like most of the younger people here. I learned a lot before education stopped and schools closed down. I want to see that world. Skies, snowy mountains, blue seas, sunshine,
palms. If I had my way, you could fly to all that in a couple of hours.
If you were free, and if I was free. I don't suppose any man has ever understood any woman since the beginning of things. You don't understand our imagination. How wild our imaginations can be. I wish I were a man. Oh, if I were a man. What are your people trying to do to us? What are you going to do to this boss of mine?
The immediate question seems, what does he mean to do to me?
Something violent and foolish. Unless I prevent it.
That's how I see things.
And if he kills you?
We shall come here and clean things up.
But if you're killed, how can you say we?
We go on. That's how things are. We are taking hold of things. In science and government, in the long run, no man is indispensable. The human things go on. We, forever.
I see. And this warlike state of ours here?
It has to vanish, like the Tyrannosaurus and the saber-toothed tiger.
Oh, so here you are.
I said I should talk to him, and I have.
I told you to leave that fellow alone.
Yes, and sat up there drinking and swaggering and looking as proud as you could, Rudolph the Victorious. And here am I trying to find out what this black invader means. You think I wanted to come and talk to him? This gray, cold man? While you're swaggering here, there are more planes away there at Basra getting ready.
Basra?
His headquarters. Have you never heard of Basra?
These are matters for us to talk about.
This lady has been putting me through a severe cross-examination. But the gist of it is that away there in Basra, new aeroplanes are rising night and day, like hornets round a hornet's nest. What happens to me is a small affair. They'll finish you. The new world of United Airmen will finish you. Listen, you can almost hear them coming now.
Not a bit of it.
What he says is the truth.
What he says is bluff.
Make peace with the airmen and let him go.
That means surrender of our sovereign independence.
But more machines will be coming and more.
And he's here, hostage for their good behavior. Come, madam, enough of this little diplomatic mission of yours.
You've got the subtlety of a bullfrog.
Yeah, I don't know what she's been saying to you. I don't much care. There's no making peace between you and me. It's your world or mine, and it's going to be mine. Royal threats of swarms of hornets and so on. You're a hostage, remember that. Don't be too sure you'll win. So just sit here and think that over, Mr. Things over the world.
Now, get round to the other side and look at these engine bearer bracings, quickly. I could get to my plane as a wireless there.
Hope Mr. won't even trust me.
You shall have to make a job of this.
I can manage to get your reserve petrol. Let me have that for this plane.
Good. It won't be easy to make a getaway. These oil pump connections aren't very good, but we'll have to risk it.
I think we'll manage it all right now that Harding knows his part of the job.
Good.
It's your Gordon. He's flying at last.
They've got him, sir, and he's in danger. I had great difficulty in getting here.
You say Cabela's in danger?
In very great danger. The boss there is a violent tough. Hmm.
Job for our new squadron.
Well, now we've got a chance to try the new gas of peace on somebody.
There's no time to lose, sir. May I report to headquarters?
Yes. Take him to the council.
At last, we have definite news.
What is it?
Gordon didn't fall into the sea. He got away. A fishing boat saw him making for the French coast. Perhaps he reached his pals.
Well,
he'll be coming back. He'll be bringing the others with him.
Curse these world communications. Curse all airmen and gasmen and machine men. Why didn't we leave their machines and their sciences alone? I might have known. Why did I tamper with flying?
Well, we needed aeroplanes against the hill state. Somebody else would have started in again with aeroplanes and gas and bombs if we hadn't. These people would have come interfering anyhow.
Why was all this science ever allowed? Why was it ever let begin? Science is an enemy of everything that's natural in life. I dreamt of those fellows last night. Great, ugly, black, inhuman chaps.
Oh, like machines. Bombing and bombing.
Yes, I guess they'll come bombing, all right.
Then we'll fight them. Since Gordon got away, I've had those air boys up to see me. They've got guts. They'll do something still. We'll fight them. We'll fight them. Ha! We've got hostages. And better didn't shoot them anyway. There's that chap Harding.
Of course. He can't tell us what to do against this gas. If I had to pull his arm off and knock his teeth down his throat. Get him! Get him!
Here's Captain Harding.
I have to come to Earth sometime. What is this world communications? A handful of men like ourselves. They're not magic.
Looking a little bleak for the human race right now, huh? Hey, but that last scene with the, you know, the chief, I guess he is, the chief, it kind of reminded me of Lord Humongous from The Road Warrior. Does anybody else get that? I mean, do you get the resemblance? Look, I have some pizza rolls, and they are very tasty. Folks, if you've never tried pizza rolls, you need to get some, because it is manna from heaven, I swear. Anyway, we're going to look at some more trailers for, post-apocalyptic and futuristic films before we get back into the conclusion of Things to Come, right here on the Alternative Realities New Year's Eve special. Thanks for logging on or tuning in. See you in a little bit. Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, the distinguished author, Mr. Aldous Huxley.
Brave New World is a fantastic parable about the dehumanization of human beings. In the negative utopia described in my story, man has been subordinated to his own inventions. Science, technology, social organization, these things have ceased to serve man. They have become his masters.
Just imagine a world where you will hold your entire future in the palm of your hand, when a tiny glowing crystal will guide you through an existence in which each day is more wonderful than the last, where it will be possible for you to obtain the fulfillment of every fantasy, the satisfaction of every vanity, the absolute attainment of every wish. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer presents the Saul David production of Logan's Run. A fantastic journey through a world beyond imagination. Welcome to the 23rd century. The perfect world of total pleasure. Imagine a world in which you need never be alone. You touch a switch, turn a dial, and the perfect lover steps into your arms. Every pleasure is yours to experience.
Runner!
There's just one catch.
When the tiny crystal in the palm of your hand flashes its final message, your time is up. Michael York is Logan.
Run, Logan!
Policeman in a perfect world.
No!
Trained to track down runners.
Run, Logan!
Until he is forced to run himself.
Run!
I'm your friend, I understand. We all go crazy once in a while. But she's a runner, and it's over.
Overwhelming, am I not?
Box, an incredible being. More than human, more than machine. Diabolical guardian of the gateway to freedom. Or Logan and the woman who loves him.
Seen a face like that before. That must be the look of being old.
MGM takes you into a new age of adventure in the first motion picture of the 23rd century. Logan's Run. It begins where imagination ends.
Communication people, have they got gas? What sort of gas?
I know nothing about gas. Tell us about these masks, anyway.
Well, they're rotten.
They're no good at all.
What sort of gas have they got?
I tell you, gas isn't my business.
Well, they can't gas us when you're here anyway.
Here they are! Listen! They're coming already!
Cabell!
Well done, Gordon!
Well, they laughed at me for sticking to my gas mask. But thanks to that, I'm here and everyone else is sleeping. I wonder if they'll ever use gas masks again.
Sir!
What is it?
This man's not sleeping. He's dead.
Dead in his world, dead with him, and a new world beginning. Poor old boss, he and his flags and his folly. And now for the rule of the air, and a new life for mankind. It'll be a long and complicated struggle, but we have the unity of a common order and a common knowledge. This is how I conceive our plan of operations. First, the roundup of brigands. That last dismal vestige of ancient predatory soldiery. The last would-be conquerors. Then settle. Organize. Advance. This zone, then that. And at last, wings over the world. And a new world begins. Do you realize the immense task we shall undertake when we set ourselves to an active and aggressive peace? When we direct our energies to tear out the wealth of this planet and exploit all these giant possibilities of science that have been squandered hitherto upon war and senseless competition? We shall excavate the eternal hills. We shall make such use of the treasures of sky and sea and earth as men have never dreamt of hitherto. I would that I could see our children's children in this world we shall win for them. But in them and through them, we shall live again.
Is any better world than it used to be? I rebel against this progress. What has this progress, this world civilization done to us? Machines and marvels. They've built these great cities of theirs, yes. They've prolonged life, yes. They've conquered nature, they say, and made a great white world. Is it any jollier than the world used to be in the good old days, when life was short and hot and merry and the devil took the hindmost?
All the same, what can we do about it?
Rebel. And rebel now. Now. Now is the time.
Why now in particular?
Why, because of this space gun business. Because of this project to shoot human beings at the stars. People don't like it, shooting humans away into hard, frozen darkness. They're murmuring.
They've murmured before and nothing came of it.
Because they had no leader. Suppose someone cried, halt! Stop this progress. Suppose I shouted to the world, make an end to this progress. I could talk. Talk. Radio is everywhere. This modern world is full of voices. I'm a master craftsman. I have the right to talk.
Yes, but will they listen to you?
They'll listen. Trust them. If I shout, arise. Awake. Stop this progress before it is too late.
Houses like that in the old days.
Why?
They'd no light inside their cities as we have, so they had to stick them up into the daylight. What there was of it. They'd no properly mixed and conditioned air. Everybody lived half out of doors. They had windows of brittle glass. The age of windows lasted 4 centuries. I never seemed to realize that we could light the interiors of our houses with sunshine of our own. So there was no need to stick them up ever so high into the air.
They keep on inventing new things now, don't they? And making life lovelier and lovelier.
Lovelier, yes. And bolder. I suppose I'm an old man, my dear, but some of it seems like going too far. This space gun of theirs that they keep on shooting.
What is this space gun, great-grandfather?
Well, it's a gun they discharge by electricity. It's a lot of guns inside one another, and each one discharges the gun next inside. I don't properly understand it, but the cylinder it shoots out last goes swish right away from the earth.
I wish I could fly around the moon.
Well, that in time. Won't you come back to your history pictures again?
I'm glad I didn't live in the old world. I know if John Cabal and his airmen tidied it all up. Did you see John Cabal, great-granddad?
Well, you can see him in your pictures.
But you saw him when he lived. You really saw him?
Yes. I saw the great John Cabal with my own eyes when I was a little boy. He was a lean, brown old man with hair as white as mine. He was the great-grandfather of our Oswald Cabal, the president of our council.
I take it the space gun's passed all its preliminary trials, and there's nothing left now but to choose the two who are to go.
That's going to be the trouble.
Thousands of young people have been applying. Young men and young women.
I never dreamt the moon was so attractive.
Practically, the gun's perfect now. There are risks, but reasonable risks. And the position of the moon in the next 3 or 4 months gives us the best conditions for getting there. It's only that the choice of the two now that matters.
Well?
There are going to be difficulties. That man Theotokopoulos is talking on the radio about it.
He's a fantastic fellow.
Yes, but he's making trouble. It's not going to be easy to choose these young people.
With all these thousands offering themselves.
We've looked into thousands of cases. We've rejected everyone in perfect health, or anyone who had friends who objected. And the fact is, we want you to talk to two people. There's Raymond Parsworthy of General Fabric. You know him?
Yes, I know him.
And his son.
We want you to see the son, Maurice Parsworthy.
Why?
He asks to go.
We think you ought to see him. He's waiting here.
Is Maurice Parsworthy there?
He's on his way.
Good. You want to talk to me?
Forgive me, sir. I'm straight to you.
You're asking a favor.
A very big favor. I want to be one of the first two human beings to go around the moon.
It means danger. Great hardship, anyhow. You realize there's an even chance of never coming back alive. A still greater chance of coming back a cripple.
Give me credit for not minding that, sir.
Yes, a lot of you young people don't mind that. But why should I give you a favor?
Well, I'm the son of a friend of yours. And people seem to feel you oughtn't to send someone you don't know, sir.
Go on.
We've talked about this over and over again.
We?
Yes, both of us. It's her idea even more than it's mine.
Her idea? Who is she?
Someone much closer to you than I am, sir.
Go on.
It's Catherine. Your daughter. She says you can't possibly send anybody's child but your own.
I might have known.
Today I'm going to put it to the world plainly. Is this thing to go on? Or are we sane and normal human beings to put an end to it? And an end to all such follies forever? What is this progress? What is the good of all this progress onward and onward? We demand a halt. We demand a rest. The object of life is happy living. We will not have human life sacrificed to experiment. Progress is not living. It should only be the preparation for living. They staged the old Greek tragedy again. And a father offers up his daughter to his evil gods.
And that voice is sounding to the whole world.
No. The old slavers have taken new names.
They'll have to hear him and make what they can of him.
What does this space gun portend? Make no mistake about it. The slaveries they put upon themselves today, they will impose tomorrow upon the whole world. Is man never to rest, never to be free? A time will come when you in your turn will be forced away to take your chance upon strange planets, and in dreary, abominable places beyond the stars. An end to progress. Make an end to this progress now. Let this be the last day of the scientific age. Make the space gun the symbol of all that drives us, and destroy it. Now!
I wonder what they will make.
Great-grandson of John Gabel, the air dictator, the man who changed the whole course of the world. You've got experiment in your blood, you and your daughter. But I'm more normal. I don't believe my boy would have thought of it. The two of them must have got together.
They'll come back together. This time there's no attempt to land on the moon.
When is this great experiment to be made? How much longer have we got before they go?
When the space gun is ready.
Sometime this year, do you mean?
Soon.
Then, Is there no way of saving our children from this madness?
But would it be saving our children?
Well, here they are.
Father, where to go?
Yes, you're to go. 2 hours ago.
Your speech has struck fire. All the people are excited and angry. Some are already going out of the city towards the space gun. Nothing is wanted now but leading.
We must go right on with this. To the space gun. And so we end an age.
Young people, just beginning life. You want to go into that outer horror. Why don't you send somebody who's sick of life?
They want fit young people, alert and quick. And we're fit young people. We can observe and come back and tell.
Cabal, I just want to ask you one plain question. Why did you let your daughter dream of going on this mad moon journey?
Because I love her. And I wanted to live to the best effect. Dragging out life to the last possible second is not living to the best effect. The nearer the phone, the sweeter the meat. The best of life, Passworthy, lies nearest to the edge of death.
I'm a broken man. I don't know where honor lies.
You haven't got things right, Passworthy. Our fathers and our fathers' fathers cleaned up the old order of things because it killed children. It killed those who were unprepared for death. Because it tormented people in vain. Because it outraged human pride and dignity. Because it was an ugly spectacle of waste. But that was only a beginning. There's nothing wrong in suffering if you suffer for a purpose. Our revolution didn't abolish danger or death. It simply made danger and death worthwhile.
Cabal. Cabal, the gun's in urgent danger. It's a race against time now to save it. Theatocopulus is up with a crowd of people already. He's going to the space gun now. They're going to break it up. They say it's the symbol of your tyranny.
And their weapons?
Bars of metal. They can smash delicate apparatus. They can do endless mischief.
But you have a traffic control. Can't they produce the police?
Very few. We've nothing but the gas of peace, and it isn't ready. It'll take hours yet. We must hold this crowd back at any cost for a time until the gas of peace is ready.
This...
Jean's astronomical department, space gun.
Well, we've stopped the airways. They'll have to go afoot. And they'll take an hour or more to get there, even those who've already started.
That gun mustn't be broken up. After all the final experiments have been made, when everything was ready...
When everything was ready?
If they smash up that infernal gun, then honor is satisfied and you needn't go.
They won't smash the gun.
Suppose the gun was fired now. Wouldn't the cylinder reach the moon?
It would miss and fly into outer space. It's five now. If the gun were fired before seven...
And it could be.
Yes.
Then...
We go now.
No.
Oh, I don't know what to say, but don't go.
Oh, but, Father, we must go now. We may never go. And then for the rest of our lives, we'll feel we've shirked and lived in vain. We must go now.
quickly. This way. If you go up to the platform, we'll guard this below.
Right.
Contract all your muscles when the concussion comes. In 5 minutes, you'll be able to get loose and move about.
What do you want here?
We want to save these young people from your experiments. We want to put an end to this inhuman foolery. We mean to destroy that gun.
We have a right to do what we like with our lives, with our sort of lives. We don't grudge you your artistic life. You have safety, plenty, all you want.
We want to make the world safe for men.
No one prevents you.
How can we do that when your sons and inventions are perpetually changing life for us? When you're everlastingly contriving strange things. When you make what we think great seem small. When you make what we think strong seem feeble. We don't want you in the same world with us. We don't want this expedition. We don't want mankind to go up to the moon and to the planets. We shall hate you more if you succeed than if you fail. Destroy the gun!
Before you can even reach the base of the gun, it will be fired. Beware of the concussion! Beware of the concussion!
Stand by, control room. Observers.
feel that what we've done is monstrous.
What they've done is magnificent.
Will they come back?
Yes, and go again and again, till the landing is made and the moon is conquered. This is only a beginning.
But if they don't come back, my son and your daughter, what of that cabal?
Then presently others will go.
Oh, God, is there never to be any age of happiness? Is there never to be any rest?
Rest enough for the individual man. Too much and too soon, and we call it death. But for man, no rest and no ending. He must go on, conquest beyond conquest. First this little planet and its winds and waves, and then all the laws of mind and matter that restrain him. Then the planets about him. And at last, out across immensity to the stars. And when he has conquered all the deeps of space and all the mysteries of time, still he will be beginning.
But we're such little creatures. Poor humanity is so fragile, so weak. Little animals.
Little animals. And if we're no more than animals, we must snatch each little scrap of happiness and live and suffer and pass. Mattering no more than all the other animals do or have done. It is this or that. All the universe or nothingness. Which shall it be, Oswald? Which shall it be?
See there? We finished the film before the ball dropped. There is still time to, you know, turn your channel over to ABC and watch Ryan Seacrest, or whatever his name is, do a poor job of filling in for the late, great Dick Clark. However, I wouldn't recommend you turning over to Vortex Channel 29, Where the Stars All Shine. Because the only thing you're going to see there is a ghost and a pink slug. And who wants to see that the very first thing of the new year? I mean, I don't. So, tonight's film, Things to Come, was based on the novel from 1933, Shapes of Things to Come, by H.G. Wells. Yeah. He's the guy that is responsible for War of the Worlds. Remember that one? Yeah. So, at any rate, in 1936, this film was produced, and H.G. Wells actually wrote the screenplay for the film and was very integral in its production. The film accurately predicted the beginning of World War II to within about, 16 months? That's pretty amazing. However, I am very glad that World War II did not go on as long as this film portrayed it to. I mean, we'd still be at war. Anyway, there are many scenes in this film that are very similar to things that are going on in our world today. You know, lots of the topics that are covered in the film have relevance in today's modern society. However, I don't want to dwell on that because, you know, it's New Year's Eve. We need to be happy and celebrating and having a good time. So, happy New Year's Eve to you. It's almost time to break out the bubbly, pop the champagne, and We can blow on those little horns and things come out of them and wear funny hats. I like this one. This is not a funny hat. This is my sleeping hat. Anyway, I am Dr. Sigmund Zoid, and Sluggo and I will be back with you in just a couple of weeks with a new trip into an alternative reality. So keep tuned, and we'll see you later. Happy 2013 from all of us at Alternative Realities. Good night.